Hey, welcome to Destined Win TV. I'm Perry Black, and as you know, we are studying verse by verse the book of Acts. And in today's program, we are studying Acts chapter 19, so get your Bibles out. Also, I want to let you know, if you'll go to your favorite app store, you can download our Family Church Bryant app. Be sure to add the word Bryant. And all of my notes are there. You can follow right along. You can even hook it up to your television set with the appropriate app as well. So be sure and do that and join us in our Bible study. And if you're enjoying these Bible studies, why don't you email me and let me know that. And the information should eventually show up here on the screen. And so join us in our Bible study. You know, the Scriptures tell us we're not only supposed to be followers of Jesus, but we're also supposed to become disciples. And so join us. Well, I'm going to start today's message in Acts 19 with a verse from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. Also, I want to encourage you to join us right here at Family Church Bryant. Sunday mornings, we have two services and small groups in the month of October, 9 and 11, small groups at 10, Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. I'd love to meet you. And I'd love to greet you as well. If you're looking for a great church where the Word of God is not compromised, join us at Family Church Bryant. We believe a church alive is worth the drive. So look forward to seeing you. Have you got your Bible out, your iPad, your Bible study notes? So if you do, let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, at a very interesting passage in Acts 19. And why is it so important? About aprons, hankies, and the Holy Ghost in this generation. 2 Timothy 3:1 says this, but know this. Romans 6 says, knowing this. You know, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. That's why we should be students of the Word, rightly dividing the truth. Listen to this verse, verse number 1, 2 Timothy chapter 3. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. The word in the original text in the Greek for perilous means dangerous or difficult. It's also translated, the original Greek word in Matthew 8:28, exceedingly fierce. Exceedingly fierce. Now, have you watched the news lately? Have you seen what's going on in our world? Right now, as we are teaching this message, wildfires raging throughout the West Coast, riots in many of our major cities, every weekend, multiple murders and shootings in many of our major cities. Folks, this is a time that is exceedingly fierce. And the answer to the need of our times is Jesus, His blood that was shed for us to give us a new heart, a new start, a new eternity, and because He rose from the dead, He sent the Holy Ghost. Can I get somebody to say amen? Holy Ghost has been sent as God's gift to us to empower us to live in times that are exceedingly fierce without fear. For we've not been given a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. So because times are dangerous, we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, as we've been studying the book of Acts, and we are moving now into Acts chapter 19, let me lay the context of Acts 19. Aquila and Priscilla, who have become partners in ministry with the Apostle Paul, they've encountered a guy named Apollos, who is an elegant speaker, but he only knew of the baptism of John, and he was teaching what he knew faithfully and elegantly. So they pulled him aside, and Apollos, though he was a powerful speaker and minister, he was instructed in the way of the Lord more accurately. You know, as we study the Word of God, we should be students that grow in the knowledge of God more accurately. In other words, we should never come to a place that we think we know it all. As I've said before, when you think you know it all, you don't know it at all. And really, Christianity is not about knowledge. It is about a practical, personal relationship with Jesus Christ who comes to through the person of the Holy Spirit to give us revelation, knowledge, and understanding of the will of God and the ways of God. So Apollos has now been instructed in the way of the Lord more accurately. in Acts chapter 19, verse 1, "And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And there in Ephesus, Paul finds certain disciples." We will find here momentarily there were 12 of them. "And he said to them, 'Have you received the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost since you believed?'" One translation says, "Have you received the Holy Ghost after you believed?" In a previous show, we quickly covered this thought that when we receive Jesus, we are certainly assured of our destination. But when we receive Jesus, according to John 4, we receive a well springing up. According to John 7, when the Holy Spirit is given, Acts chapter 2, we receive a river flowing out of our belly, but this spake he of the Holy Spirit, which was not yet given until the day of Pentecost. So we have, it says, "And when he asked that question, they looked at him and said, 'We haven't even heard whether there is a Holy Ghost.' And he said to them, 'Well then, how were you baptized?' They said, 'We were baptized unto John.' And he says, 'Well, John's baptism is a baptism of repentance, saying that you should believe, future tense, on him that should come after him, John. And that is on Jesus Christ.'" So my question for you in this segment of our Bible study, real simple, yet so important. Have you received the Holy Spirit after you were born again, since you believed? Why is that important? Because in these fiercely dangerous times, we need a river of God that will take us into His holy presence and empower us to live the living Word of God. We'll be right back. Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Arkansas Christian Academy, Central Arkansas's fully accredited premier Christian school and one of the best kept secrets in Saline County. But we are growing throughout this summer and we are opening August the 10th, and we would love to give you and your family a tour if you would just contact us at 501-847-0112. God bless. Hey, it's Pastor Perry right here at Arkansas Christian Academy, and our special guest on this segment is Reed Patty.
How you doing?
Reed is one of our seniors, and he's also one of those in the top of the class. So Reed, tell me a little bit about you. How long have you been coming to ACA?
It's been about 3 years now.
3 years. You guys moved from Cajun country.
Kind of.
From Louisiana.
Up north in Louisiana, yeah, so it's a little...
So they don't eat Cajun food in North
no,
Louisiana?
No, we do. We do. It's just not as... Not as many swamps.
Yeah, true, Dad. I know what you say. And so, y'all been here for 3 years. You attended a Christian school in Louisiana as well.
Yes, sir.
How many years did you attend there?
I was there for 5 years, I think.
And you've been here 3.
Yes, sir.
And did you play sports here at ACA?
Yes, sir. Basketball and football.
Basketball
First
and
time I've
football.
Ever played football.
You got any awards that you had this year in sports?
I got All-State for basketball last year. And I don't think we did any awards this year.
You didn't get MVP in the championship game in Oklahoma?
No, we didn't hand out an MVP because
yeah.
we didn't.
But we made a tremendous comeback in that game. We just barely didn't win the championship.
Yeah, it was heartbreaking.
So what's been your experience here at ACA? We've got a relatively small student body compared to a typical public school, but what are some of the things that stand out in your mind about ACA?
Well, being small, when I first moved here, I almost didn't come here just because I didn't want to go to a school so small. But it made it a lot easier to just get in and get used to everybody and adjust to moving for me. And so I think a lot of people coming over would see that same thing.
Yeah. So what about your relationship with the teachers? Did you get a lot of support? Did you even need support?
Well, I did sometimes.
Yeah, you did.
But If you need it, just because there's not as many students, they can give you the support you need in whatever way you need. So it really is interactive and helpful.
Yeah, and here at Arkansas Christian Academy, we start every day, Monday through Friday, with chapel right after we check in and have homeroom. How has chapel, is that something that's been impactful in your life and the life of your siblings? Because you have a sister that goes here as well.
Yes, sir. I had chapel at my old school too, just once a week. And having it every day, it's it's cool because sometimes, you know, you're not motivated to get up and go for a day of school, but it can just happen in the morning. It can
start every day with praise and worship, and then go straight from our praise and worship into Bible study, and from Bible study right into our curriculum. And it's been a tremendous blessing having you here. Your mom also has been, this past year, has been our executive assistant in the elementary building. So if you'd like to take a tour, why don't you call Reed's mom, JJ Patty, and take a tour at Arkansas Christian Academy. Thanks for watching. God bless you. Hey, welcome back. I hope you've been to the App Store and got our Family Church Bryant app. In it, not only do you have our notes, you also have the videos and a place to honor God with your giving. As a media member, why not plant a seed in the ministry that is God is using to speak truth into your life? And I will assure you this, we are faithful stewards of the finances God entrusts into our care. And that's why everything we do here is debt-free, because we believe in honoring God and supporting missions ourselves. We support world missions through probably 15 or 16 missions throughout the nation and the world every month. So a portion of your gift will go straight to missions 100%. So God bless you for being a part of our show and joining us as we're studying here. In our previous segment, Paul asked that question, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed or after you believed? They said, we don't know what you're talking about. He said, well, what baptism were you baptized in? They said John's baptism, which was a baptism of repentance, that they should believe on the one coming after them, that's Jesus Christ. And when they heard this, obviously they received this revelation from the Lord, and they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So they had already experienced John's baptism. Now, the baptism of the believer in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when Paul laid his hands on them, what happens? The Holy Ghost came on them. Now, if you receive the Holy Spirit when you accept Jesus, these folks had received Jesus, they were baptized, then Paul lays his hands on them and the Holy Ghost came on them and they spoke with tongues. They received a heavenly language. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 explains that, as does 1 Corinthians 13. And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord. Paul lays his hands on them. The Holy Ghost comes on them and they spoke in tongues and they prophesied, and there were about 12 of them. So my first point is a profound one, and that is the Holy Ghost empowers us to be witnesses. Not to witness, He certainly does that, but He empowers us to be witnesses of the greatness of God's grace. And the Holy Spirit gives us a prayer language. Jude, verse 20 says, build yourselves up on your most holy faith, not in, but on your faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians 14 talks about praying in the Spirit and praying with your understanding. 1 Corinthians 14 says, he that speaks in tongues does not speak to men, but speaks to God. Divine mysteries. So the Holy Spirit gives us a prayer language. That's why the question so important in dangerous, fierce times is, do you have your prayer language? Are you filled or baptized by Jesus in the Holy Ghost and fire? And have you received your prayer language? You know, the movie, I think it was called The War Room, where the lady went into her prayer closet and called upon heaven and called heaven into the earth. Our prayer language, according to Romans 8, prays in divine mysteries according to the will of God. And we know when we ask anything according to His will, we know He hears us and we have what we've asked of Him. The second thing the Holy Spirit does, this is so important, when the Holy Spirit comes to fill and immerse you, He brings 9 gifts. The inspirational gifts, 3 of them. 3 revelation gifts and 3 power gifts. Maybe sometime in the future we'll go into much detail on these 9 gifts. And the Bible tells us the Holy Spirit divides these gifts or manifests these gifts as He desires to, and it's so that we would profit with all, so that it would benefit us. 1 Corinthians 14 says, he that speaks in tongues edifies himself. He that prophesies edifies the church. That means we morally, spiritually build them up. 1 Corinthians 14 says, inasmuch as you're zealous of spiritual gifts, seek that you may build up the body of Christ, the church. So Holy Spirit also, according to the words of Jesus, will teach you all things. How many of you want the teacher to reside in you and come alongside you, living in you, leading and guiding you into truth, giving us revelation knowledge, because revelation knowledge is what produces faith. Holy Spirit also will bring everything to your remembrance that Jesus has said. And I'm going to tell you, at my age, I need the Holy Ghost to bring to my remembrance all the things Jesus has said. The next thing He does, the Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. I have a friend that attends the church, and he was telling me just last week that he's a fishing guide. And he said he went to the lake in 2 months, caught several thousand crappie. I go to the lake and the crappie look up at my boat and say, nah, Perry's up there. What do we need if we're going to be efficient fishermen? We need a guide. What do we need if we're going to be effective in our discipleship and in our ministries as ambassadors of Jesus Christ and ministers of reconciliation? We need the Holy Ghost as our guide into all truth. And it says also the next thing the Holy Spirit does in my notes, Holy Spirit will tell you things to come. Well, here we are living in perilous, dangerous, fierce times, yet we don't have to be afraid. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is our guide. He guides us into truth, and He shows us things to come. Back in the fall, if you've been following us, the Holy Spirit told me this, and I shared it with you. I've shared it multiple times. 2020, a year of trial and tribulation. It's exceeded what I even anticipated. And then it would be a time of what? Outpouring of the Holy Ghost. A time of revolution, outpouring, awakening, and revival. And I believe November is the third trimester since March of the birth of God's great awakening. I believe sometime between November, the 1st of November, and Thanksgiving week, we're going to see a mighty move of God that is going to begin to come to the surface, and we're going to see a mighty outpouring of Holy Ghost the latter part of this year and into 2021. I believe God leads us and shows us things to come. John 16:33 says this, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you might have peace. But in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer." Oh my. "Because I have overcometh the world." And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. That's why we stand on the promises of God. That's why we never quit. We never give up. That's why we press on in faith. The Bible says that we should be immovable, steadfast, standing on the promises of God. We're going to take another break and we will be right back. Hey everybody, Perry Black here along with Rachel Hubbard from Second Chance Youth Ranch. And Rachel, we've got a big event coming up, our annual fundraiser. Can you give us some information about that?
October the 13th, 7 o'clock at the Benton Event Center, we're having our annual fundraiser. Goal is to raise $250,000 to open a new home. Socially distanced, very careful, following all the guidelines, but we'd love for you to join us.
Hey Rachel, I want to sponsor a table. What does that mean?
All you have to do is send us a donation. You can contact us through the website.
So a table sponsor is about $1,000.
About $1,000 each.
And then I invite my friends to come and be exposed to the ministry of Second Chance Youth Ranch on how we can change the world one heart and one life at a time through fostering, mentoring, and adoption.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that a great opportunity? So why don't you just tell people right now how they can reach us?
So reach us by going to our website, 2cyr.org, and click Contact Us.
We look forward to hearing from you. Hey, welcome back. As we close the previous segment, we ended with these words from Jesus, "But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Yes, we may be living in dangerous, fierce, or perilous times, but the words of Jesus ring true, and that is we are of good cheer. Why? Because Jesus has overcome the world and through faith, we overcome the world. Verse number 8 of Acts 19, Paul went into the synagogue and spoke boldly for the space of 3 months. Now, let's just stop there for a moment and think about that. What's being taught at your church? Do you realize the Apostle Paul is teaching the revelation of the Messiah, the revelation of the resurrected Jesus? And who's he speaking to? He's speaking to his Jewish people in their gatherings in the synagogue. And yet he's speaking boldly. And yet we have come in some cases in a generation where clergymen are the clergy, which are not all men now, where ministers are afraid to speak boldly the truth about the virgin birth, a sinless, perfect Jesus, a crucified Jesus, a dead, buried, and resurrected Jesus, and a Jesus who rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sent the Holy Ghost to empower us to be witnesses of Him, the resurrected Savior. Are you willing to speak boldly from the pulpit? Are you willing and able to speak boldly the truth of God in your Sunday school class, in your cubicle at work, in the marketplace, in the public square? Paul spoke boldly for 3 months in the synagogue. I find that fascinating. Why wouldn't it just say, and Paul taught in the synagogue? Because it took holy boldness in a Spirit-filled apostle named Paul to speak with an authoritative word from heaven that would bring revelation to those who choose to believe. And it says, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. But when different ones were hardened and believed not, different ones were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of the way or of Christianity before the multitude, he departed from them. Jesus, now listen carefully, I'm not trying to be rude, but Jesus said, you don't cast your pearls before swine. They'll just trample it underfoot. So we have to be Spirit-filled and Spirit-led. We see that in the life of the Apostle Paul all through the book of Acts. And it says, then Paul departed from them, separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of Tyrannus. And this continued for 2 years. And so that all that dwelt in Asia, are you ready for this, man? This is fulfilling the gospel call, the Great Commission, Matthew 28, Mark 16, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And Paul did this for 2 years, and all those that dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus Christ, both Jews and Greeks. Now, it didn't say everybody believed, but it did say he preached the word and everybody heard it. Matthew 24 says it's so important that this gospel be published through all the earth. That doesn't mean everybody's going to believe. But that doesn't give us any slack on not preaching, publishing, proclaiming the gospel. Everyone has the choice to choose to believe or reject the truth. Paul kept preaching. Now listen to this next verse, verse number 11. This is powerful. Are you ready? And God wrought special miracles. Can you say special miracles? You know, a lot of us would just like to see a miracle. Paul was used by God with special miracles by the hands of Paul. God wrought special miracles. I'm going to say it again. What kind of miracles? Special miracles. The New King James says it like this. God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul. Extraordinary miracles. Here is a profound point. When I was rereading my notes, I got excited about this point right here. Are you ready? If there are special or unusual, or one translation says extraordinary miracles, doesn't that indicate that miracles, you know, just ordinary miracles, should be usual to the believer? Think about that. If there are special, extraordinary, unusual miracles, to me that indicates that the miraculous ought to be the usual. It ought to be the normal. And maybe for some of us, that is our new normal in perilous times. So that from the body of Paul were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the disease departed from them, and the evil spirits went out from them. Did you see that? There is such tangible anointing in the ministry of Paul that even the apron that was on him, cloths that were taken from him, the anointing was so powerful, palatable, tangible, that they took those cloths, laid them on sick people, and they were healed. Woo! That's unusual. And those who were possessed of spirits left. I tell you, I feel the Holy Ghost. I feel the presence of God right now infiltrating your living room, your bedroom, your hotel room. Right now, the tangible presence of God, His Shekinah glory flowing powerfully right there where you are. Will you just reach out to the Lord by faith right now and say, Jesus, I need you in my life. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Now listen to me. The woman caught in adultery, her accusers left, and Jesus said, woman, go and sin no more. Thy sins are forgiven. Do you understand the forgiving power of Almighty God? Don't void His holy presence where you are right now. Right now, do what I did in my jail cell. Jesus, come into my life. Touch me. Save me. He did it in my life, October 26, 1972. And then in January of 1973, I got filled with the Holy Ghost. August, I went to Bible school in 1973. I was full of the Holy Ghost. I started getting full of the Word of God. And the power of God continually to this day is changing my life. I believe He's coming to you right now. Will you just pray with me? Jesus, I need you in my life. Come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me my sins. I believe you died for me and you rose again. Jesus, I give you the best of my life for the rest of my life. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again right here at Destined to Win TV next time. I'd love to hear from you. See you soon. Bye-bye. 2 Timothy chapter 2, I believe it is, says that the servant of the Lord must not strive but be gentle and apt to teach, that God preadventure would grant people repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, that they might save themselves from the snare of the devil. What does that mean? You just keep loving people, keep teaching the Word of God, and you know what God will do? He'll open people's hearts, and what was just absolutely stupid and asinine and just ridiculous a moment ago, boom! Jesus come into your heart like He did me.